everyone, and welcome to the last first devlog for my first real Steam release. My name's Matthew, I've been trying to get a game on Steam for a while, and I realized I just need a deadline. So I signed up for Steam Next Fest, which is in 2 weeks now, and I only signed up 4 weeks ago, which is 6 weeks total, so I wanted to share the first month of progress on this game. First thing I did was register for Steam and actually become a developer. And then I decided to work on a store page right up front. I do have a little bit of an advantage here because I already made this game, sort of. This is Motherlode from the 20 Games Challenge, which is the base foundation what I want this game to be. So I'm going to start over on the actual game project, but this is essentially my prototype. I already have it. So starting with this prototype, I took some screenshots and created some capsule art and put a Steam page together, got that up, and then realized I am going to need a trailer if I want to submit to Steam Next Fest. I started with a concept trailer, wanted to work out what I wanted this to look like. This is also my first time voice acting ever, and I was on a very tight time schedule, so I didn't get to be a perfectionist about this. I just recorded some stuff, cut some video together, and boy, it's terrible. Mayday! Mayday! Is anyone out there? Mayday! Mayday! I'm sorry, crew. It looks like this was our final flight. Yeah, okay, that's enough of that. Does this represent the gameplay?
Yeah.
Yeah, no. But this is where I want to go with this game. So it was good to get this together. I ended up realizing a better option is going to be to just cut together some gameplay footage with text, which seems to be what Steam trailers really want to be anyways. I might release like a cinematic trailer or something on YouTube, but as far as on the Steam store page, people just want to see gameplay. So this was all I really needed in order to qualify for Next Fest. So I got this trailer together, put it on the store page, and with that, I was farther than I've ever been as far as releasing a game. So the next step was to do another thing I've never done before, a design document. And this was a little bit scary because I have struggled with scope in the past. I think most developers have. And I'm starting to see why people recommend creating a design document. I legitimately thought this was going to be a single page document. But I started writing, found a quick framework, and started putting in different things of, okay, here's the game story and the game lore and how the art's going to look and et cetera, et cetera. And it just grew and grew and grew the more stuff I put in. And so I eventually reached this point of just, man, this is even a small game. This is big scope. And I'm going to need to cut some of this down. But I'm really glad I got here in week 2 instead of figuring this out in week 12 when the game's still not done. Why is it taking so long? This is why I believe why I've been failing to finish a lot of games is because I've never actually done this up front. I'm always just like, let's feel it out as we continue to grow this game. And next thing you know, I have a 5-year project, even though I started trying to make a 2-month project. I also then spent some time working on some mood boards. As you can see here, I have the planet I want this to be on. The story is going to be you are a captain of a passenger vessel. So I got some spaceships, and then you are going to be underneath that vessel. You're going to be in almost like a moon pool underground. So I have some hangars here, but you're going to be operating a drilling vehicle. So I took a lot of inspiration from deep sea exploration vehicles, just thinking of the pressure you need to be under. So these were some of my mood boards for those. And then I'm also going to have a large boring machine in the final version of the game. This isn't in the demo, but I want to have a transportation vehicle where you can go to different areas of the map to mine different resources. And the idea is you're trying to fix your ship, but every time you die, you actually have to open a life pod, one of your passengers, because you need more crew to be able to continue to manage this rescue mission to save yourself. So your final score is going to be the number of people who survive. Another major element I want to have there is corpse running, where if you run out of fuel, you're not dead, you're just waiting for your life support to run out. So if you can quickly go and rescue your past self, you can save that life. You can also salvage other stuff out of there. So these were all the major elements I wanted to put in. So the next thing I did was put together a schedule of all my major milestones. The only set in stone deadline is Steam Next Fest itself, but I have September 30th marked as the time when I need to have a playable working demo done. The next thing I want to do is the art experiments. I had this fun idea for a 3D to 2D pipeline. A lot of people do nostalgia in the sense of we're making pixel art, but I thought it'd be fun to actually target a different kind of nostalgic games and do the 3D sprites. So things like the Command and Conquer, or Diablo, or even Roller Coaster Tycoon took a real 3D object and then scanned it down into a 2D image. So this was my attempt at doing this real time in the game engine, and it took a while, but I got it working and decided this would be the base for all of my art. Next thing I was going to do was take all of the core systems out of Space Rock Survivors, the other game I was working on with this. And this is really less of a cancellation, more of a pivot, because I was 90% systems and 10% gameplay. I just got burned out working on the actual gameplay and spent a lot of time doing all of these back end things that I thought were interesting. So it was really easy to just pull that in and have saving and loading and menus and configuration and all of these different things just working out of the box. The next thing I set up was a tile map. I just wanted to have some placeholder minerals and spent a little bit of time here trying to figure out my approach. Ended up creating a tile index. So I have this index here, which will then convert into the actual tile map. So I started with some random generation. I ended up not going too far in that direction because for the demo, at least, I can just hand paint a map in less time than it would take to write a whole bunch of noise and generation and make that look convincing. I may randomly generate like the caves, so the holes in the ground, I don't have to place all those by hand, but then I will sprinkle the actual minerals in by hand. So that was the approach there, but I have this system that will convert this one tile index into all the different tile map layers. And then if I'm reading information like, hey, I'm mining, what kind of mineral is this? I just check the index. So I don't need to actually go, okay, which layer? Was this a mineral layer or hazard layer or whatever? It's just, it's all in the index. So that was a really good approach once I figured it out. I then started working on super basic art. So I have my final art, I just threw a shader in, and I have a nice toggle between the programmer art and the real art. So this allows me to prototype the gameplay while it doesn't look great and go, does it feel awesome to play even when it doesn't look awesome? And then on the other side, when I turn that on, I go, does it look awesome even when I'm just staring at it? And if both of those are true, hopefully the overall game is really good. The next thing was to figure out my minerals I wanted. So I didn't want to do the standard, if you've played like the factory games, there's iron, copper, coal, you know, there's a standard list that a lot of games have. I thought it'd be interesting to come up with something else, but being a little bit too much of a nerd, I didn't want to just make up fantasy minerals. So I ended up finding this website called Mindat, which is a list of all sorts of things. So I started with, you're going to be using aluminum is going to be the basic element, but instead of bauxite, which a lot of games use as a, you know, that's the aluminum ore, there's another one called alunite, which is a crystal that is found near volcanic areas. So I went, you know, this could be on a warmer planet, more like a Mercury type versus a Mars type. So this could form naturally, and that is your aluminum. Went through a bunch of other minerals and had same ideas. So, okay, your fuel source is actually going to be sulfur instead of being any sort of hydrocarbon, and just kept going that way. I took a material science class back in college, and I thought it'd be really funny if I used four different variants of iron. So as you're digging through, you know, the whole point is you're going to have this material processor thing, kind of like they had in Subnautica, where you just pass in the raw elements and it creates anything you want. So it's going to be weirdly picky. You show up with martensite and it's going to go, oh, no, I can only use perlite for this, even though they are actually both just carbon steel. So I thought that was really funny. I figured nobody would actually get it, but, you know, sometimes you have to leave jokes in just for yourself. So with that, I started going through and doing a whole bunch of work in Blender to create these. The four iron variants actually became a bit of a pain in the butt because I was using this resource now, but these variants, these are microstructures. At the surface level, they all just look like steel, you know, gray metal. So I had to get creative in figuring out how to represent these microstructures at a macro level. And to be fair, these other ones, I'm actually modeling the molecular structure as well. So, you know, maybe they don't look like this shape at the large scale, but it was just easier in Blender to create the molecular structure and then sprinkle them around with a particle system. The next thing I did was put all of this into a custom tool, which allows me to create sprite sheets from these 3D models. So this was all within Engine and Godot. I mean, you go, hey, don't you know that Blender has an export button? Yes, I do. But if I use the export button in Blender, it's going to look like it was exported from Blender. And so if I want to also have my character running through a viewport in Godot, it's not going to match. So I created a sprite sheet tool to make everything rendered in Engine in Godot, so it all looks the same, even though the sprite sheets are just an image and the player character is actually a 3D model that is being rendered at runtime as you're playing the game. So the next thing I needed to do was replace my placeholder player with an actual player. And again, being a engineer first, I wanted to make something that was mechanically plausible in my mind. So I was thinking through the practicality of how all these things would look. I actually grabbed some sprites of different components and, okay, where's the engine? Where's the drive chain? How is this all connected? I had a circular pressure vessel that the player can be inside. So, okay, that can connect through magnetic inductance. So it's not, you're not passing wires through and creating stress points in the sphere, and did all of this thinking. That was maybe a little overkill, but in my mind, it was making a very plausible vehicle. The funny thing is I got to the end and went, wow, this looks a lot like a standard tractor. I now understand why tractors are designed the shape and size that they are, because that's actually a very logical approach for this, which hopefully doesn't look too generic, but I definitely thought through each step of the process as I was gray boxing this. And yes, this is still a gray box model. I haven't put this back in Blender yet. So my thought would be I will come back, and I specifically designed this so when I'm animating, I am rotating base components. So I have a node titled drill with the actual 3D mesh for the drill underneath that. So as I did the animation player, I'm just rotating this basic node that is holding the drill, so I can just replace that individual mesh with something I make in Blender later. But then did some animations and spent a lot of time learning how to use the animation tree, because I've never done that before. All of this, the Blender and the animations, was a 60-hour week. So this was the most work I put into this game, at least on, you know, hours per week. But overall, I was very happy with the result until I posted it to Reddit and realized it doesn't really, a lot of the colors don't work right now. The good news is I don't think the 3D models are bad. I think that it is the shading I need to spend some time on. So I got some advice on, hey, you need to work on contrast and saturation. So I added a overlay shader, which I can use to tweak some of these things. And so I noticed here the Alunite, it looked bad. I didn't know why. And somebody pointed that out to me. So now if I toggle this, you'll see when I go to grayscale, it disappears into the background. And so that is something I can fix pretty easily. And that doesn't involve me redesigning the 3D model. I actually separated out the shaders and now have all of these shaders have code. So I can tweak the shaders in my Sprite Studio, and that will be everything. You know, I can use the same shader on the player themselves. So I'm going to spend more time experimenting on that, but it was good to get this far and to get some feedback and go, okay, I need to do more work on this. At this point, I kind of got stuck. This was about 3 weeks in. I was nearing my deadline to have the demo done, and everything was complete. It looked okay, but it wasn't done. I had more items on my checklist, and I was trying to figure out why I was getting stuck. It was almost when you're writing, it's called writer's block. I don't know what it's called for a game developer, but I was experiencing this mental block, and eventually realized, you know, I am a little bit OCD, and I reached a point of very low entropy where this game was, in a sense, done. There were a number of things I needed to add, but there was nothing broken. There were no loose ends. If this was a puzzle I was putting together, right, I dumped it out of the box. I had sorted all the edge pieces, put everything else in the box, and then put those edge pieces together and went, you know, this is kind of nice. So I had to force myself to dump out all the other pieces and make a mess again so I can clean it up. So this was my final mad rush to get the core systems in. I decided while the game isn't going to be done on the 30th, it will be functionally complete. There's nothing I'm adding that isn't already in. And so that meant I needed to add things like inventory and player death and whatever. So you see, actually, with the player death, if I'm going, the fuel is running out, and I hit empty fuel, and the player dies. And I decided to die. The player just does a queue free, it deletes itself. And then another part of the code is updating the player's position for other things that might wonder where the player is, and that part of the code throws an error. And I decided, you know what? That's good enough. Because I am a programmer first, and I know this will drive me crazy, and I will fix it. But the fact that that is in means I made a mess that I will be very inclined to clean up. Well, I don't necessarily recommend making messes in games in general in that situation. It's like that was the right approach because I am taking this fairly good, clean game, and adding more messy entropy to it, which I then get to clean up in this next week. But that was my final rush to get all the systems in. So I put this up on my Discord server and just said, "Hey guys, this is the game I decided to release." And I actually put a Steam store page together. And someone wishlisted my game. And I realized this is the most successful I have been so far in the games industry. And all I had to do was put together a store page. Like, why didn't I do that for my other games I was trying to work on? Yeah, that was kind of weirdly profound of seeing that I put a game out on Steam and somebody wishlisted it. And like, that was a huge milestone. There's still a lot of work left, but I am going to be releasing the demo for Next Fest. And then I'm going to probably continue to update the demo itself and refine the demo until I reach a point where I'm happy with that, and then obviously finish the actual game and just release that at once. So that's about it for my first month of progress on this little mining game. Let me know what you think. I am pretty happy with it so far, but there's definitely a little bit left to work on. So I will be coming back probably with the demo. I was planning on doing another devlog between now and then, but I really want to focus on getting this done. Let me know if you would improve or change anything. And as always, thank you so much for watching. And feel free to check out the Steam page. If you would like to wishlist it for yourself, I would greatly appreciate that. It helps a lot. That's all I have for now, but I will see you in the next one. Thank you for watching.